Alrighty, yo, what is going on, everybody? It's your boy, Mr. DDG94, back with another reaction video today. We are reacting to my favorite fucking movie. This is my favorite movie. This is where I got all my macking from. Listen, if you trying to learn how to mac, if you trying to learn how to get that game, if you trying to learn how to get that dog in you, my nigga, this is the movie you have to watch right here. This is how I got my game. Mostly, I got most of my game from my dad, but this movie helped me out too. And watching this movie with my dad and him spitting the game to me and giving me the, you know, giving me the answers to the test, this really helped me out a lot. So without further ado, I would like to introduce y'all to How to Be a Player with Bill Bellamy and all these freaky ass women up in here. And the most, and Bernie Mac too. Bernie Mac was funny as fuck in this. But without further ado, let's get right into it.
Your girl is sweating me, okay?
She's sweating you because you need some AC.
Oh, RIP to homegirl right here. I forgot her name, but RIP to her. It's sad that she passed away. Yeah, RIP.
Open this mother.
Also, this is by the young lady that I told y'all about. She's gonna give her female perspective. We ain't here for that. We just here to hear me teach y'all how to mac. We just here for the nostalgia and for me to teach y'all how to mac. I would have did A Thin Line Between Love and Hate, but that shit was an hour long, bro. I'm not reacting to no hour long video. You got me fucked up. It's bad enough this one 40 minutes, but still, I'm not reacting to no hour long video.
Now, after doing my Boomerang review, I started getting so many requests to review this film. 5 minutes into it, I totally see why it was recommended. Oddly enough, this film has similar scenes and themes as A Thin Line and Boomerang. Also, this is a 97 film. And I don't know what it was about the year 1997, but baby, the black creators were in their bag.
Facts.
But Dre was an absolute miss. A scoundrel. A schemer. A slut bucket.
Y'all see what I mean, right? This young one. Now, fellas, we're going to be respectful. We're going to be respectful here. But if she do get out of line, and we got, if she do get a little out of line. You know.
And as always, I've noticed a few things while watching this movie. And you know we're going to talk about it, so let's get into it.
This is my shit! Hey, this my Hey, we going to react to the soundtrack after this one, too. Because the soundtrack to this movie is fire, bro. Especially that motherfucking 8-Ball MJG. You know what I'm talking about.
We starts off in a typical 90s black movie fashion. We walk into a scene, things are happening, and we see a peek of the ending. And of course, we have
R.I.P. Gilbert Gottfried. Yes, Gilbert Gottfried is in this movie, too. This movie is goated, bro. This is my favorite movie. See, when I did the certified hood movies, I did that in the consensus of everybody else. I didn't really give my true list. If y'all really want my true list, this would be in my top three. Could I put it at number one? If you're going to include Scarface, then I can't put this at my number one. If you take out Scarface, this is my number one. I love this movie.
To figure out how we got here by watching the rest of the movie. Well, baby, Dre is getting his soul snatched by a shinkashay. And his girlfriend Lisa comes in and she's seeing all these questionable things in his apartment. Clearly something is going on. She finally catches him in the act and baby, he's about to go in.
What the hell's going on in here?
Lisa?
Son of a bitch!
But of course, it was a dream and we are officially introduced to Dre.
Getting caught is a bitch.
So I've heard. This is a player song. This is the players. This is for the players right here, man. Come on, man. This is a player song. Yes, sir.
We see him getting ready for the day, loving on himself in the mirror, getting rid of evidence. Speaking of evidence, this guy is the king of covering his ass, okay?
Facts.
First off.
Because, baby, he a Mac. Macs don't get caught. Max don't get caught. That's the thing about being a player, being a Mac. You don't get caught. It ain't cheating if you ain't getting caught. Let's keep it real, fellas. Am I telling any lies? Am I telling any lies? It ain't cheating unless you get caught. Fuck out of here. Fuck you, me. This nigga is the GOAT. This is my movie right here. This is how you gonna learn. Hey, for my young fellas, this is how you gonna learn how to be a Mac. Please, lock in.
He gets rid of the panties, erases the voicemails, and speaking of the voicemails,
he doesn't get rid of the voicemails, he switches out the tapes. Now see, this is back in the days with land phones. We got cell phones now. See, the cell phone, I'm gonna tell y'all like this right now. The cell phone is basically the biggest snitch against all that's really why a lot of niggas getting caught, because of the cell phone. What y'all need to do is you need to stop using the cell phone. Don't get no burner phone. Don't get no ops. No. Don't hop on no Twitter or no Facebook or nothing like that. No. What you do is, you send out a stress call. You send out you put the bat signal up. Basically, in your phone, you put you text this one number. You keep this number in your shit. You don't save it. It's just a random number. And you and that person have to not, I repeat, y'all don't communicate through talking on the phone. Y'all don't talk on the phone. You just send a signal. You send a little message on the phone, like an eggplant emoji. You send an eggplant emoji, she send back something else freak. She send back a freaky ass emoji. It's up. We up and we gone. That's how you supposed to do it. You delete it. You know what I'm saying? You never call this number. You never call the number, because if you call the number, that's how you get caught. If you don't call the number, it never gets caught. So you and the person that you fucking around with, you got to keep, if that's your side bitch, I'm telling y'all fellas, if that's your side bitch, We on a emoji text basis. I text you an emoji, you text me a freaky emoji back. If she don't send an emoji, if she send back a sentence or a paragraph, then okay. Option one, plan B ain't feeling it tonight. So plan C, hit her with the emoji. She send the freaky ass emoji back. It's up, my nigga. You delete the message right after that. That's all y'all gotta do, bro. Stop calling bitches. That's what they got text messages for. Because you can delete. And then they go, and your girl go in your call logs. You ain't called this number in like a year. But you been fucking on her. Trust me. When the phone gets called, she's not gonna answer because she knows the play.
Like, when were these created? Was it over the course of a week, a few days, a single day? Ew. And it's during this scene where we are introduced to the whole panel. Baby, we got a Caribbean girl, a white girl,
yes,
a
Lord,
cougar, and some girls speaking French. Baby, a whole roster on the voice.
Yes, Lord.
Oh, but he's not done. He changes the photo in this frame to reflect his main girl, Lisa, who just so happens to be knocking on the door. One thing I thought about when it comes to Lisa is, first of all, she's played by Lark Voorhees, who played Lisa Turtle in Saved by the Bell. I never noticed she had the same name in this movie as she does in the series, but then she...
Hey, all that is gone, man. She fucked her whole... I don't know what happened. She was getting plastic surgery and shit, and the surgery botched like a motherfucker. She don't look like this no more, bro. It's a goddamn shame. It's a goddamn shame. It's a goddamn shame, bro. She had a couple of surgeries, bro. Botched. She don't look nothing like this no more, bro. She out here looking bad. But back in these days, though. Nah, fuck that. Fuck that. Back in these days, though. Back in these days. I'm saying, though. Back in these days, though, boy. Baby girl could get it. Not now, though. Them surgeries fucked her up.
Works in fashion in this movie, and Lisa Turtle loved fashion, so I immediately went to the credits to confirm her last name. And her character's name is just Lisa, no last name. So I don't know if this was intentional or just a coincidence, but anyway, she comes in to see him before she goes to work. She looks so pretty here. She comes in to see his place is a mess. He immediately tries to get him some, but she doesn't have time since she has volunteered to clean his place and cook him breakfast. And clearly, this is a casual thing, but there is no way. I'm not cleaning your place in mine. That's too much. She then goes in his room, and as she's picking up his jeans, she sees his wallet and decides to check it for numbers, which there were none. She only finds a picture of her. She then glances at his voicemail and notices there are 7 unread messages, and she asks him why he hadn't bothered to check them.
So I'm sure you won't mind if I check them, right?
Do I come over your place and go through your stuff?
No. Dre, because you know I have nothing to hide, don't go there. We are talking about your machine.
So Dre immediately makes her feel guilty about checking his machine. And as he finally agrees to let her hear it, her guilt makes her regret asking. His plan works. Manipulation 101.
You don't have to play.
Yes, sir.
No, Dre, we're gonna leave it there because you know what? I trust you.
So Dre goes down to get the mail and talk to the freaky ass doorman. He's just casually reading
Gilbert Gottfried the GOAT
in the lobby. And you know, as soon as Dre
Gilbert Gottfried the GOAT, man. R.I.P. to the homie.
And she does. And instantly regrets it.
Hi, Dre, it's Mama. How you a sweet little Lisa doing?
Oh my God, it's Mother.
Dre, this is Grandma.
It's Grandmother.
Meanwhile, Dre.
Yes, sir. Gilbert Gottfried the GOAT, nigga. The motherfucking GOAT. Gilbert Gottfried, man. RIP to the homie. RIP to Gilbert Gottfried, man. He was hilarious in this movie, bro. For real. RIP, though. RIP, though. RIP. For real. RIP to Gilbert Gottfried.
Knows that there's a high chance that Lisa is going to snoop, so of course he's covered his bases already.
Switch the tape.
The most trustworthy girl will check.
Switch the tape.
So just change the tape.
I'm not sure how long he was.
Fellas, are you taking notes?
But by the time he comes back up, she's already made him pancakes and eggs. As he sits down, the phone rings and Lisa teases like she's going to answer it, but decides not to because she trusts him, which is unfortunate because one of his other girls are on the line.
Hello.
Hi, baby. Did you get my message?
Sure I did.
I love you.
I love you too, baby.
After he hangs up the phone, she asks him who he was talking to. And the crazy part is he tells her the truth, but because he says it in a joking manner, it goes right over her head.
Who was on the phone?
Oh, Sherry, this big booty girl I was born last night.
From here, his sister Jenny, played by Natalie DeSalle,
R.I.P.
her comedic timing.
R.I.P.
She carried. And she was so cute here as well. She comes in like fire. Child, she's coming over to get one of their mother's pots for the barbecue and to bust her brother's chops. She couldn't wait to plant a seed in Lisa's mind.
Girl, I don't know why you sweating over that stove, baby. He ain't nothing but a roach-ass ghetto pimp.
So as Jenny goes to get the leftover pancakes, it's time for Lisa and Dre to say goodbye to each other. And baby, Jenny hears something that no sister wants to hear about their brother.
Tell Mandingo I'll see him later, okay?
Tell him yourself.
No,
talk
Dre.
To him, just talk
no.
To him.
And their sibling banter is so hilarious. Jenny instantly gets on him about Lisa and how he doesn't deserve her. And you know Dre is not trying to hear that at all. And while the sibling banter continues, there is a knock at the door. Jenny's friend Katrina is here to meet her. At first, Dre is not excited to meet another one of Jenny's friends, but that quickly changes once he opens the door.
Yes, Lord!
Hello there.
Baby, once he sees her, he can't even concentrate. He's fumbling all around, yes. Looking all nervous.
Yes! And she's, and she's still looking good to this motherfucking day. So you already know.
My mind's telling me no. But my body's telling me yes. Baby, I don't want to hurt nobody. But there is something that I must confess.
I'm telling you, boy, I tear that ass up, boy. She's still looking good. She's still looking good. I tear that ass up, boy. Got me fucked up. I tear that ass up, boy. I tear that ass up.
You's a freaky ass nigga.
You goddamn right.
As Katrina compliments his place, Jenny starts with the planting of the seeds.
You have a really nice place, just some cheap shit.
Child, this whole scene is hilarious. It's a sibling battle to the 10th power. Katrina lets Dre know that she's heard a lot about him, and Jenny lets Dre know that what she heard is all facts and not the fairy tale that he'll try to sell her.
Yeah, I told her everything about you.
What?
How you a pimp and a player and you got all these hoes chasing your ass.
He tries his best to divert Katrina's attention, but Jenny's coming in hot with the truth. He then goes on a tangent on how sister's friends are a dream because they hear so much about you and want to figure out if it's true.
Facts.
And then we go back to
fellas, are you taking notes? Fellas, are you taking notes? This movie is teaching you the game. It's teaching you how to Lamac. I'm trying to help y'all. I can be sort of a guru, but I'd rather, from now on, I'm your guru teacher. And today, we watching this movie. Get your notes out. We taking notes. You got your notepad down? Take notes, fellas. Because it's the truth. It's the truth. If you got a cousin or a friend of a friend, if you got a cousin that has a friend, or you got a friend that's a friend of a friend, you know what I'm saying? And they telling you, and they tell them about you and how you rock, them motherfuckers don't care. Them motherfuckers wanna fuck. I'm telling you, they wanna fuck. They trying to see. Even though they already know about you, they trying to see for themselves. They trying to see what's good with it. You say he this and he that. I'm trying to see what up with it. That's how it be, bro. This is real facts, bro. This movie ain't no fucking like. This ain't no Hollywood shit. This ain't no white boy making. No, this is real life Mac player shit, bro. If you really trying to be a Mac, if you really trying to be a player, if you trying to get that dog in you, pay attention to this.
So wants to know if he truly is what his sister says, and Jenny doesn't even give him a second.
Get your notepad out. Hear me? Get your notepad out. Get your notepad out.
There's another buzz from the lobby.
Right now.
Jenny's boys, Lee and Kilo, are downstairs waiting for him. But before he heads down, he invites Katrina to a Malibu party. And Jenny tries her best to rescind the invite, but it's not working. Dre then signals for Jenny to meet him upstairs so that they can talk about Katrina in peace. Dre is convinced Katrina wants him.
Yo, girl, wants to give me somebody.
Like, how does he even know this off of a simple conversation?
Because he know he's a player in your macaroni. We know.
Like how?
No.
Your girl is sweating me, okay?
She's sweating you because you need some AC up in this motherfucker.
Meanwhile, Katrina is hearing all of this. Homeboy forgot this was a loft, but they continue going back and forth. Jenny declares that women like her and Katrina are far too smart for Dre's bullshit, but then Dre swiftly pulls her card.
Oh, like you was too smart for Michael Jones, who dropped you like a bad habit.
Why you throw him up in my face like that?
Baby, she is clearly traumatized. And then Dre goes on to say how he tried to warn her about him, but she didn't listen. And because she didn't listen, she's now a statistic. This asshole. But he didn't bet on Katrina hearing this.
Now you're just a statistic.
Facts. Yes,
and I'm going to have a bomb.
Making your girl Katrina statistic too.
And as he leaves, Katrina's whole vibe changes.
Yes, sir.
Because from this point, she knows she's got to make an example out of him. Meanwhile, his boys are teaching this freaky ass doorman about the origins of the term onion booty.
Oh, I get it, because booty is an ass, and onion makes you cry.
Yeah.
So it's onion booty. It makes a grown man
cry. R.I.P. to Gilbert Gottfried, man, one more time, man. This the OG. Man, this man is a part of our childhoods, man. This man is a part of our childhood, man. This man done so many iconic characters over the years, man, through the cartoons and shit. You gotta show love to Gilbert Gottfried, man. This nigga's hilarious, bro. His voice is iconic within itself.
Cry.
Yeah, yeah.
But before they head out, Dre asks the freaky-ass doorman if he wants a plate. He then asks Dre what would they be having, and Dre lets him know what's up in an unconventional way.
Got some candy yams, potato salad, some chicken. I can't wait.
And then it goes left. Really left.
Could you rub him a little more? Because I'm starting to get excited by it. No, come back. Come back. What the hell with these women? Bring that.
Baby, as soon as Dre leaves the house, women just show up. We meet Barbara, a fitness instructor who lives in the same building. And baby, Barbara only has eyes and clearly respect for Dre.
Did I introduce you to my friend Kilo?
Oh, hey, what's up, Sasha?
Your weight.
Damn.
Yeah, my woman that girl made me laugh. Yeah.
Baby, just rude as hell. So his friends are begging him up about Barbara, but Dre tells them that he wants no part of any woman that stays in the same building because it's destined to create problems. Problems that he is all too familiar with. But this goes right over his boys' heads.
But we don't live here!
So
nigga, that's true too. Fellas, are you taking notes? Don't fuck with women that you live in an apartment with. If you live in an apartment or a duplex, don't fuck around with these women, bro. Don't do it. Because if you do them dirty, they gonna figure out how to break into your apartment or worse, go after your vehicle or damage some part of your property to get you back, bro. Or they'll do some extreme shit and make it seem like you broke into their house and beat them up and rape them or something. Don't fuck with women in apartments, in the same apartment as you, bro. Because if it don't work out, you gonna, hey, these bitches is terrible out here, bro.
We go to another one of Dre's friends, David, who is in the middle of a situation. His girl, Nadine, is huffing, puffing, and about to knock his door down because she knows he's got another woman over, and she's right. And David stupidly tries to crack the door open. For what? I don't know.
Now, girl, didn't I tell you never come over here unless you call first?
Why you got the chain in the middle? You don't even know me!
I don't know why he thought that would work. Baby, that inner Memphis came out of Elise during this scene when she busted through that door. But anyway, Nadine comes in and it's a mess.
I can tell something's been going on. I can smell it.
Girl, you need to run. Like, what are you doing? So the phone continues to ring and Dre starts getting a feeling that something may be wrong. And that feeling is right because Nadine notices that old girl got on the same shirt that Nadine bought David.
I know that this bitch does not have on the shirt
that
I bought your traveling ass with my hard-earned money. Oh, you didn't open up a whole can of ass with a knife. What's up, Miss Natalie?
So old girl has had enough and she decides to slap the piss out of David. And you know Nadine didn't like that because that's her man. And she's the only one that can slap the piss out of him.
You alright, baby?
Come on, sweetie.
You okay?
As this is happening, Dre and his boys finally show up and they pull up to some mess. David goes from begging baby, baby, please to putting on a front when he sees his boys. The guys go into his place and baby, it's a mess. Hurricane Nadine came through and spared nothing. And Spootie and Kilo didn't spare his feelings. Not one bit.
Oh man, I'm saying, man, look how he dressed, man. He butt naked in some cowboy boots. See, now what Nadine need is real cowboy behind her. Hitting that ass.
R.I.P. A.J. Johnson, man. It's too many R.I.P.s, dog. This movie iconic, bro.
Booty stayed talking mad shit this whole movie. But David insists that he had this whole situation under control.
No, you didn't.
How he finally stood his ground. But the lie detector and the state of his living room determined that that's a whole entire lie. And then Dre asked him a question that I'm sure everyone wanted the answer to.
You know what your first mistake was, man? Why did you even bring her here?
Facts!
Why did you let Nadine in?
Why?
Look at the door. Does the door look like I let Nadine in?
You knocked that bitch off the hinge.
We go back to his sister and Katrina. They are snooping in his place, trying to find some evidence, but the CYA king already has that covered. As they're searching, Katrina asks her if she knows how many women he has, but it's coming from a place of selfish curiosity, if you know what I mean. Like, you say he a hoe, but like, how much of a hoe type of thing. Katrina tries to lighten the mood by saying that not all men are pimps and players, just as all women are not bitches and hoes. And Jenny is sensing that her girl's motivation is wavering, so she decides to help her refocus.
My brother is a dog. All of his friends are dogs, and Michael Jones is the dog of all dogs.
So that's what this is all about.
Baby girl is traumatized. But then she goes on to tell her what she's heard about her brother, and child Katrina is intrigued.
They told me how much of a cold freak he was in bed. Like with the ice, and handcuffs, and hot lotion, and nipple pinches, and feathers, and fried zucchini, and baby diapers. Oh, like I want to know all of that.
I do.
See, this goes back, fellas. Let's go back to page one. Page one. What did we talk about? If a friend of a friend knows all about you, she wants to figure out more. Fellas, are you taking notes? Are you getting it down? Take notes. We gonna take a test at the end of this.
Yeah, Katrina's definitely trying to f***. We go back to Dre and his boys. They are still talking about women, and he lets his boys know that his sister is snooping through his place, and he knows all about it. As this is happening, we go back to see Katrina sitting on his bed, having fantasies about Dre, hearing his voice. This girl is as good as
yes, girl. Yes, sir.
Thanks to Jenny, Katrina's a done dish. The booty is just marinating for me.
Facts.
He decides to call his house phone so that he can prove to his boys that he knows what's up. And Jenny answers the phone, acting like she's one of his many women to mess him up. But it doesn't work in her favor.
Stop, baby. Stop.
What you doing answering my phone?
Huh?
I'm caught red-handed. Mouth wide open.
Baby, this must have been before caller ID. But anyway, Dre tells them he knows about their research plans. Jenny then tells him that he might as well enjoy his last moments of being a player because she's about to blow his game up. But Dre is not worried.
How many times I gotta tell you players never get busted?
Facts.
I am so sick of brothers thinking that they are players.
Oh, like Michael Jones?
Baby, his cover is blown, and Jenny realizes that he had her on speakerphone to flex in front of his friends. Justin hurt the girl's poor feelings. She hangs up in his face. He ends up feeling bad and tries to call her back and apologize, but it's a no-go. In Jenny's mind, it's on and popping. Mission take down a player has begun.
I got a display for his ass. We going to Maxwell's party so all his girls can meet in the flesh.
Create a hostile environment and a player will repent and reform.
So from here, we meet some of Dre's girls. The first girl, well, woman, is Robin, an unhappily married cougar.
This the funny,
Dre
hey,
comes in and Robin instantly Bernie, starts
R.I.P. to Bernie Mac, because he controlled this whole scene, bro. This scene is funny as fuck.
Complaining about her husband, Buster. And while Dre's trying to make her feel better, guess who pulls up in the driveway? Yep, you guessed it. Buster himself.
Who you what?
Buster sees Dre's boys outside playing music all loud in front of his home, and he confronts them.
Cut your fucking music down in front of my house, man. People live on this block. You beige motherfucker.
I mean, he goes in.
R.I.P. to Bernie Mac. R.I.P. to Bernie Mac. But hey, the soundtrack to this movie, though, fire, bro. I'm telling you, we're going to listen to the soundtrack after this movie, bro, for real. Because the soundtrack to this movie is fucking fire, bro.
And when he comes in the house, Robin and Dre have to think quick on
their feet. Oh, man.
Robin is obviously startled by his presence and asks him this.
Honey, why are you here?
Yeah, she clearly doesn't like her husband. And by the way, his attention goes straight to the plants. He might subconsciously feel the same way about her.
You take care of my babies? My plant?
Yes, I have.
They look kind of dry, honey.
They're not dry,
sweetheart. They look dry to me.
And while he's checking on his plants, she notices Dre's jacket on the arm of the couch. And to prevent Buster from seeing it, she tells him that she saw a bug on one of his plants. This distraction allows Dre to leave the room, but baby, Buster still knows something's amiss.
No. Baby, it's stinking here. It's starting to fuck with my heart.
Oh, honey, it's your asthma. Come have some tea.
Meanwhile, Dre's boys pull back up even louder than they were before. But Buster ain't worried about them because he's finally about to get him some.
You got my oven on again. I knew we were going to make love again after 4 years. I'm going to drink my ginseng.
Did this guy just say 4 years? Child, she don't want you. But as soon as he gets excited, he gets an unsuspecting surprise.
Dre!
Drain! Don't worry about the drain. The drain is fine.
Who in the fuck is this?
Clearly, Dre is quick on his feet because he done made up this whole story about him being a plumber. And Buster actually believes this and offers to refer him to his neighbors if he gives him a card. And while reaching for the card, something else comes out of his pocket.
She ain't played the best part of this scene, though. She ain't played the best part of this scene. Hold on, I got something for y'all. If you ain't never watched this movie, you in for it. Like I said, Bernie Mac killed this scene, bruh. Bernie Mac killed this scene. Bernie Mac had the funniest part of this whole scene, bruh. Where's it at? Here we go.
It smells like booty, dick, and pussy.
she missed out on the best part of that whole scene, bro. It smelled like booty, dick, and pussy, but dussy.
We go back to his sister and Katrina, and they are brainstorming and trying to figure out what Stray's password for his Rolodex of sorts could be.
What do these women really mean to him?
Oh, girl, all these women mean to him is pussy.
And child, it's on and popping. We go back to Dre and his boys. Next stop is Amber, the wannabe actress. Dre warns the guys that this is not the neighborhood to be blessed in their music in, and he makes his way inside. And much to David's shock, Amber is not what he expected.
You ain't got a fine sister.
Hey, it ain't nothing wrong having a white girl, man. They be some freaks, though. Hey, they the ones that's willing to do some shit for you. They're the ones that buy you a pair of Jordans. Them the ones that'll buy you a PlayStation. Shit, them the ones that'll, the white girls will pay for you. You know what I'm saying? If you want the reverse effect of the Zion Williamson treatment, get you a white girl. But as a black man, me personally, just remember them bitches crazy.
And apparently this excited Kilo and Spooty, because baby, they hop out the car so that they can get a front row seat. Meanwhile, Amber is ready for her role, child, given 90s Spice Channel realness, okay? And while Spooty and Kilo continue to try to find a way to view the show, if you will, David takes this as the opportunity to reach out to Nadine, but it's not going well at all.
You can't call me baby, okay? See, you've got to earn this shit, okay? As far as I'm concerned, your tired ass is dismissed.
Poor David, he round here fronting, trying to be a player, and it's not working for him. Meanwhile, Spooty and Kilo have found a way to spy on their boy. But Kilo gets a little too excited and lets one go.
Damn, why you let it go?
Why you let it go?
Meanwhile, Jeannie and Katrina are inviting each girl to the Malibu party at Maxwell's.
They was dirty for this. They was dirty for this one, bruh. But it's cool though. It's cool though. Let's keep it moving. Let's keep it moving.
Boys, and we're off to the next girl, Ashinka Shay, who ironically Jenny and Katrina call while she's doing Dre, straight up interrupting their session.
Did I catch you at a bad time?
Oh, woman to woman. Hell yeah. Who is this?
Girl, stand up. And Jenny wasn't grossed out enough for me, because if that was my brother, I would have dropped the phone and poured bleach in my ears. But she goes on to invite her to the party. And baby, Ashinka Shay's adventurous and sex crazed, because she don't want to let Dre go. And Dre would have
had... Fellas, there's a reason why this scene is censored. Let's just say she had something that vibrates. And she tried to bend my boy over and do some freaky shit. I'm going to just tell you like this. Listen, if you into that shit, go right ahead. Me personally, hell to the motherfucking nah. You got me fucked up. I ain't finna do none of that freaky ass shit. You got me fucked up. If you a freak like listen, I'm a freak, but I ain't no freaky ass nigga like that now.
You's a freaky ass nigga!
I ain't going that far. Like, I'm a freak in the sheets, but I'm not a freaky ass nigga. My freaky level goes as far as baby oil, whipped cream, and chocolate syrup. That's as far as I go. And strawberries. That's as far as I go. Now, when we start including sex toys, that's where you lose me. So if you into that shit, hey, do you. If that's your kink, get off on that. But if you do the, me personally, any type of sex toys, I can't do. Like I said, my freakiness goes as far as baby oil, whipped cream, chocolate syrup, and strawberries. That's it. That's as far as I can go.
Had me messed up. We around here sitting outside in the Cali sun while you freak on all your women. We trying to get to the barbecue and eat.
Facts.
This is not what we signed up for. And David finally has enough and decides to go in and get Dre. We go back to Jenny and Katrina, and they have completed their calls. And it's then that Jenny finally remembers why she originally came over her brother's house. This girl totally forgot about the pot her mama needed, so they rush over to the barbecue. We go back to David, who has gone up to get Dre. He walks into Ashinka Shay's apartment and gets the shock of his life. It's a whole new world in there. And while David makes up a quick lie about his sister, Ashinka Shay referencing the call from earlier lets him know that she knows, and he's confused because he just made up a lie. But really, he was too focused on this to even care. We finally make it to their mom's barbecue, and these boys are begging for hot sauce. I wonder how they are now. They were in everything around.
Facts. Hey, what happened to these twins, bro? I need to know, bro. What is up with these twins? Are they okay? Are they safe? What is going on with y'all? We miss y'all. We need y'all back in these hood movies. I don't feel like a hood movie could be a hood classic without the big twins right here, man. We need them. Where are they at? Where have they been? Are they okay? How you doing? How's your health? Are you good? Did you make it off the quarantine? We just want to know.
Time.
These niggas are all stars.
Barbecue. They catch David trying to, baby, please, baby, baby, please, Nadine.
I done told y'all I'm too through with that headache. This is my new girl. It's Maria.
Why the fuck you lying?
Why you always lying?
When it comes to the food, Kilo understood the assignment. He tips the uncle on the grill.
Facts. Facts. But at every cookout, always slide the grill man at least a dollar or five. You slide him a dollar, get you a glizzy or a burger. Now if you slide him a five, and get you a chicken wing and a burger or a glizzy. Slide a 20, go ahead and get you a whole plate. Shit, you ain't gotta tell. They give you the tongs and everything. Get you a plate, boy. Get you a plate. Shit, you ain't gotta tell me twice. Shit, get you a whole motherfucking plate, my nigga.
But clearly, David should have followed suit. Dre's mom asks why he didn't bring his girlfriend, and Spooty almost sells him out by asking which one. Mama don't know he a ho-ho out here, and it's clear that only Lisa is mama worthy. We then go to the table where everyone's eating, and why are they reaching over Katrina's food? They're going to pull back a nub. Rude. And why was Jenny staring at Dre so hard?
What kind of dog are you? A poodle? Or a chihuahua?
I'm wondering, where should I send your ass? To Jenny Jones? Or Jenny Craig?
Jenny, being in her petty mood, tried to introduce Katrina to David. But maybe David only wants Nadine at this point. The boys spot Peaches, one of their Uncle Fred's girls, so Drake suggests that they go meet him.
Yes.
See, Uncle Fred is the whole entire reason Dre is how he is.
Yes.
We go back to the grill master, if you will, and I swear he has on the universal grill master uniform.
Facts.
The hat. The
facts.
Shirt.
Talk your talk, sister. Talk your talk.
But he goes on to take digs at these boys, and baby, they squashed it real quick.
Oh, look at him. Looking like two big M&M's sitting over there.
Man, to heck with you, you old drunk. You don't know nothing.
You know, if I had a saddle on my mountain, I'd kick your fat ass.
Nah, he didn't have the sandals. See, that's why that chicken burnt. He not bringing the right energy.
Facts.
Kilo goes on to ask Uncle Fred for advice, and baby, he spews the most toxic shit I have ever heard in my life.
The woman shit is typhoon.
The motherfucking goat. Ladies and gentlemen, we must pay respects to the Mac. The one and only Mr. Motherfucking Goldie, my nigga. Let's go, man. What is we talking about here? The motherfucking living legend himself. R.I.P. to him, though. R.I.P. 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 But still, this man right here is a legend. This is Goldie. In this movie, he's Uncle Fred. But we all know him as Goldie. If you never watched The Mac, okay? Now, The Mac is the original player movie for the pimps and the hoes out there. Now, that was a pimp movie. The Mac was a pimp movie. It wasn't like this. It was back in the 70s. It was one of those black exploitation films. But man, hold on, because I gotta educate y'all, because we gotta pay respect to the man himself. This is the player of all players right here. Let's see here. Goldie. Pretty Tony. Goldie and Pretty Tony. I'm gonna show it to y'all right here. I gotta educate y'all, man. I gotta educate y'all. If I don't, who will? The old heads don't want to educate y'all. The old heads don't want to educate y'all. I'ma educate y'all. Now, excuse the quality, but remember, this is a movie from the 70s. You see, that's Goldie right there. We gotta pay homage to the OGs.
That ain't shit. That's
Chump Chain.
Get in there.
R.I.P. to Richard Pryor.
Damn, man.
A little while ago. What
was
you?
Nine.
Fellas, y'all about to learn some game right here. But baby girl go up to Goldie, you about to learn something today.
I've been with this 2 years.
2 years and I ain't touching. I got $200,000 off for. Watch this. Watch this, y'all.
Hey, man, this China.
Hey, baby.
Hey, how you doing?
Remember me?
I'd have to lose just all the brain cells in my head before I get something as fine as you.
Does everyone need an audition to get with you?
You ain't gotta go through all that shit.
Then I choose you.
Be cool, baby.
Hey, bitch, come here! Got your motherfucking man, come here!
About to learn something, fellas.
Mr. Pretty Tony, I mean, you know the rules of the game. I mean, your bitch just chose me. Now, we can settle this like you got some class, so we can get into some gangster shit.
You shade tree nigga. You ain't no pimp. You're a rest haven for hoes. You're a car thief. A car thief. The one you got out there is probably hot as a firecracker right now.
It was $35,000.
$35,000 cash money?
No, I get $35,000 plus one, right?
The one I gave.
No, you gave me six, though, right? That was one. I had one, it was six, and $35,000 plus one plus six leaves seven. $35,000 and seven, right? Motherfucker, can you buy that?
That.
It's
on. Next time you hear grown folks talking, shut the fuck up, you hear?
Go get it, Bob. Bring the bitch here.
Freeze, nigga, you wanna die.
Is this where it's gonna be, man?
Champagne.
I'm gonna make you wish you never was born, nigga. Let's get out this dump.
Fellas, did you take notes? This is an OG, this is a classic right here. This is definitely a movie you should watch if you're trying to learn how to mac the ladies, man. But this is the movie. This is the modern day macking. That was the old days macking. That was in the 70s. Okay? That time frame is kind of outdated. This is still kind of modern. Some shit you got to update with, but this is still pretty modern in today's time frame. This movie right here. But definitely, I just had to show y'all that to pay homage to one of the greatest to ever do this. R.I.P. R.I.P. to Goldie. Motherfucking GOAT. Macaroni. You saw how he did Pretty Tony? He said, you know the name of the game. Yo, bitch chose me. Now we can sell this like we got some class and we can get into some gangster shit. Because that's how it works. When the baby girl come up on here, she said it herself. She said she choose you. Would she leave another nigga for you? You gotta stand your ground. You know what I'm saying? Can't be mad at the bitch. You can't be mad at me. You can't be mad at the bitch. That's just how the game is played. And she choosing me over you. Can't be mad. You just gotta charge it to the game, my chief. If you a Mac, if you a true Mac, you never get mad on losing somebody on your roster to one, another nigga. Because you can always Mac another bitch to replace her. Free game.
Birth. Because you see, a woman wants to be played. Has to be played. Needs to be played. In order for the continuation of this man-woman thing.
Straight bullshit. But anyway, the boys leave out and say goodbye to Dre's mom. And as Dre says goodbye and makes up an excuse as to why he has to go, Jenny quickly realizes that she's going to be stuck helping her mom clean up after the barbecue. Yeah, she don't like that. And Dre is a trash-ass friend because he straight up strands Spooty and Kilo at the Blue.
What am I about to do now, lady?
Yo, y'all about to go to the bus stop, kid.
Like, how you gonna do that? Why he couldn't drop them off but kept David? He don't mess with them for real, y'all. But David goes to try to call Nadine yet again, and Dre tries to stop him. And Spooty and Kilo are walking towards the bus stop. They run into Buster yet again, but instead of warning Dre, they decide to let the chips fall as they may and continue off to the bus stop. They were in their feelings, but it's not too long before they spot Buster for themselves.
What?
Buster.
Baby, they are out of there, and Kilo and Spooty are living for this. As they are laughing at Buster and making jokes, baby, Buster spooks the hell out of them.
What's that fucking wrong with you? You got fucking wrong with me. Yo, this
Dre and David make it back to Dre's place to get ready for the Malibu party. Dre tells David that he's about to freshen up and get ready, but David reminds him that he's been wearing the same thing all day and needs a fit for the party. Dre reluctantly offers to lend him a fit, even though he has trouble giving them back.
This time, you gotta return my stuff, man.
I ain't got none of your stuff.
What about the blue shirt I let you hold?
What blue shirt you let me hold?
This blue shirt?
And finally, the plan is underway. We get a montage of all of Dre's girls getting ready, Jenny getting hyped about what's to come, and clearly, she's ready.
Black would be more appropriate for the burial of a player.
Yeah, she's serious about this. Dre and David make it to the party. Kilo and Spooty are already there. Shortly after, they spot this lady in pink. And
yes! Shawty was the baddest one in the motherfucking party. She was the baddest one, bro. Yes, bro. I'm telling you. Baby girl in the pink right here. I move my head back. Baby girl in the pink right here, right? In the pink right here, right? Baddest one in the whole fucking party. But fellas, get your notebooks out. We still taking tests, alright? We still taking notes, okay?
To take his chances, and of course his boys stay back to watch the disaster unfold.
Hey baby, come on now. Can't get a little groove on up in here.
Child, Dre decides to teach Spooty a little something, so he starts talking about sizing up your competition. And apparently, there is none.
Check my man out right here in the green.
What you looking at?
Oh, snap, it's Arsenio Hallway.
And then this guy.
That ain't no real player supposed to have no page. Why would you want your woman having all that access to you? But your woman should definitely have a page.
So you can all have access to her. But see, it don't work like that nowadays because pagers are outdated. So you gotta upgrade to the cell phones, ladies and gentlemen. You gotta upgrade to the cell phones. Like I said, this is still technically modern. Just gotta update it a little bit. Gotta update your firmware a little bit. But other than that, though, this is still pretty modern.
Exactly.
Child, if toxic masculinity was a movie, So Dre's plan to get the girl in the pink's attention is in action. First step, ask.
Fellas, are you taking notes? Get your notepads out because this is extra right here. Listen, look, fellas, you gotta do this. You gotta do it. Even my pops told me this shit worked. And I did this shit myself one time at a party. Nigga had all the bitches trying to get at me, bruh. Cause I know when I stepped up in the scene, I knew I was cold, bro. And I picked up I walked over to, you gotta get a girl that's not the best looking. We talking like a 4, 5, a 3 even. Probably a 2. Now this girl right here, she would be a 5. Because I'm gonna tell you this right now. Like I said in the other video. Or like I said in a video before. I don't remember. The ugly girls are the freakiest ones at the party. Always remember that. The ugly girls are the freakiest ones at the party. They also the hypest. So when a dude like you, you know what I'm saying, you good looking, you got your hair cut right, and your hair is cut right, you know what I'm saying, you got the fresh ass suit on, you got everybody looking at you, you smooth with it, always gotta be smooth. That's how you really get the ladies. Confidence, smooth, clean, that's how you get the ladies. So you walk over to the least good looking woman, you pick her up and you ask her for a dance, you ask her for a drink, you treat her like a gentleman, as you should, fellas. Always treat women like a gentleman. Don't never treat these women like they hoes. They not hoes, bro. Like I'm teaching y'all, like I may be teaching y'all how to mac and how to play and shit, all this, but still treat the ladies like women. Treat them like you would treat your mama. Treat them with respect. Always treat women with respect. Don't never call them no bitch. Don't never play with them like that. Always give them your time and your energy because, man, you never know, man. That's how you keep them, bro. That's really how you keep them. You always got to give your time and your energy. Always give your time and your energy. But, yes. Always get the ugly girl first. Then you proceed to treat her like a gentleman would treat any woman, like she's beautiful. And by doing that, you get the other girls to start paying attention. Like, what? He like that? Oh, he nice? Now they finna make they move on you. And when they start making they move on you. You in there! You winning! You know what I'm saying? You winning, my nigga! You winning, bruh. For real, you winning, my nigga. You winning. You winning, bruh. Just don't fuck up. Just keep it smooth. Don't be desperate, though. Always play it smooth. If you treat those women just like how you treated her. Be kind, be gentle. Offer them a drink. Be a gentleman. You know what I'm saying? Be smooth. You know what I'm saying? That's all you gotta do, bro. This shit, this method really does work. Picking up the ugly girl and making all the more attractive girls be like, what?
So random, less attractive girl to dance. And baby, this girl is excited, okay? She was just waiting for the opportunity. And he plays the hell out of her.
Girl, you got a pretty smile. What's your name?
Nikki. Child, she is showing out, you hear me? But his plan is working because he's got the girl in the pink's full attention. We go back to Jenny, Katrina, and baby Jenny can't keep the reins off of her. But she finds a way.
What's wrong?
They end up spotting Dre as he's dancing with this girl, and after they're done, baby, she done got a whole fan club because everybody's trying to find out how and why. So not cool. So not cool. Dre goes to the bar to get a beer for the girl he was dancing with and bumps into another girl wanting a dance. He promises to dance with her later and goes over to hand off the...
Fellas, when they ask you to dance, you tell them later. You tell them later. Always tell them later. Don't try to go out on a dance floor with them right now. Play your cards right. See what else is out there before you go out on the dance floor. Because once you go on that dance floor with that girl, the fine ass girls, that's the girl you taking home with for the night. The other girls is going to bow out. So make sure you always check your options before you make that. But always continue your play right here. You see how he continuing to play right here, right? Y'all taking notes, right? Y'all taking notes. So understand. He's still in the play. He's still messing around with the less attractive girl. You see how he's still in the play. You still gotta play this shit off.
The beard to the girl he was dancing with prior. He requests that she says to dance for him later. He don't really mean that shit, because as soon as girl in the pink requests to dance, it's checkmate. Game over.
Yes, sir.
And Jenny and Katrina are looking at him at disgust. Well, Jenny is. Katrina, not so much.
You gotta give it to him now. The brother is smooth.
Yes, sir. I told you. We going back to lesson one. See how lesson one is playing out throughout the movie?
Good is gone at this point. From here, things get interesting because all Dre's girls enter the party right after the other. They end up spotting Amber and know that Mission Takedown, a player, has started. And Amber is getting all the attention.
You ain't looking over there. Don't you know I will cut you?
Baby, David starts seeing all Dre's girls and decides to give Dre a heads up. He is shocked, but tries his best to keep his cool. As he walks through the party, he runs into the girl that asked him for a dance earlier. And baby, why was she getting so possessive? You don't even know him.
Don't even trip. I'm his sister.
She's adopted.
Hey.
Another one of his girls runs up to him shortly after, and he's able to tap into her weirdness and get her to go somewhere else. He then promises this girl, yet again, that he will dance with her. Baby, if you don't find someone else, ignoring all the red flags. Dre then runs into this Caribbean girl, and baby, he fakes a whole accent for her. It's then that Dre officially starts to freak out.
Every woman I know is in this party.
Child, this weird flower child girl comes up again, asking where is Dre, and David sends her off in another direction. It's soon after that Dre realizes that Jenny and Katrina didn't set him up. It's game time now, because Dre is not going to let his sister win. And as he's walking around the party, trying to avoid everybody, he gets snatched up.
This is...
Like I said, the least the ugly girls are the biggest motherfucking freaks, bro. I'm telling you.
My mind's telling me no.
I'm telling y'all, bro.
But my body,
the ugly girls are the biggest freaks. If you trying to beat them cheeks that night, get you to take the ugly girl home. There's nothing wrong with taking the ugly girl home. Cause trust me, I done had a few of them. And your boy done had a few of them.
You gonna freak me ass, nigga?
Ain't nothing wrong with taking home the ugly girl. You wanna know why? Cause them ugly girls loyal as fuck, bro. Them ugly girls loyal as fuck, and they fall in love fast too. When I say ugly girls fall, let me tell you something about ugly girls, bro. They fall in love super fast, bro. And another thing too about them, they will introduce you to their family right out the gate. They'll take you and have you meeting everybody, meeting their friends, meeting their mama, meeting their sisters and brothers and all that. Ugly girls fall in love super duper fast, bro. And they want to introduce you to everybody. Now it's up to you. You could be a player and just be like, nah, I'm busy right now. I'm working overtime. Or nah, I got to help my grandma with something. Yeah, you kind of caught me at a bad time. I was supposed to go help my grandma with something today. Yeah, she needs something done around the house, and I'm just trying to help her out. You know, she got a bad leg, or she got gout, or she got breast cancer, or something like that. You know, she can't be really doing too much these days. You know, she got diabetes and shit like that. Like, you got, like, if you don't want to be introduced to her family and you want to stay on your own and you want to stay independent of everything else from her, and she ain't, and you just want to treat her like a booty call, keep your distance. Only allow yourself to be available when you want some booty or some pussy, I should say. Pause. But you know what I'm saying? When you want to clap them cheeks, hit her up. When you don't want to clap her cheeks, leave her alone. I'm telling you, bro. Yes, ugly girls. Bro, it's nothing wrong with getting the ugly girl, taking her home for the night, bro. You gonna clap some cheeks. That's all that matters, brothers. As long as you fuck, that's all that matters. How many times I have to tell y'all this, bro? As long as you fuck, that's all that matters. As long as you fuck. Did you get the draws, okay? Did you get the draws? GTD. Did you get the draws? As long as you got the draws, that's all that matters. It don't matter how she look. You can hide an ugly bitch. Trust me when I tell you, you can hide an ugly bitch. I'm telling you, bruh, it's not that hard. I've done it multiple times.
The last stand. After he is.
And no, you won't be down bad. You not down bad, bro. I ain't never been down bad. My bitches ain't never been like ugly, ugly. I mean, if they got big ass titties or fat ass, that's perfectly fine with me. That's good enough for me. Because that means she look good with her clothes off. So that's the only way I'll be able to go over there, is if I see her with her clothes off. That's all you gotta do, bro. As long as she got her clothes off, you gonna wanna fuck, bro.
You's a freaky ass nigga. Freaky frog. You're a freaky frog.
I'm just telling y'all the truth, bro.
Girl's grasp, baby, every corner he turns, it's another girl he's running from. He runs into the Caribbean girl again and then makes up an excuse to go in the bathroom and gets the shock of his life.
Sherry, don't worry, baby. I'm gonna take care of you.
And while all this is going on, Buster enters the scene yet again looking for that philandering wife of his. Child, Dre runs into Amber again just in time to use her as a cover from Buster. He then gets her to leave the party by promising to meet her later for another round of role playing. He then uses this girl as a distraction to get Robin out of his hair as well by having her call Robin's name to bring Buster straight to her and run her out of the party.
Robin! Robin!
Baby, Robin makes a run for it, but of course, Buster can't keep up in more ways than one. Dre slowly causes distractions for each girl, and this ends up working like a charm until.
Yeah. Oh, what's up?
Enter Barbara, who comes to Dre's rescue and takes care of Buster. He then promises her that he will be over her place later to get her to leave the party as well. Then Dre decides to beat each girl and sends them a message to get them out of the party.
Yes, sir.
And they run out. The D must be fantastic. You hear me? Jenny's and Katrina's plan is crashing and burning. Meanwhile, David is still sad and moping around, even declines to dance with this girl. Ooh. I really hope she got someone to dance with her eventually. And surprise, Nadine has decided to show up to the party. Baby, her hair was giving peak 90s prom hair. But anyway, David apologizes to Nadine and finally admits that he was just trying to be something that he wasn't and makes a sincere plea.
Nadine. I thought I wanted to
be something that I'm not, and something I realize I never want to be. I want us to have what my parents have. That forever shit.
And baby, this girl done moved on with Kilo. Child, love that for him. And Spooty is still trying to get at somebody. Anybody.
You ever thought about me boning you in your ass in the rain?
And of course, Drake comes to
Glow. R.I.P. A.J. Johnson, man. R.I.P.
He also brings up this point to both Jenny and Katrina.
Like, if you put a player in a hostile environment like this was, he won't reform. He'll rise to the occasion and thus adapt.
But he didn't know that he planted another seed with Katrina. You'll see this pan out later.
Yeah.
But after, Jenny is down and feels defeated and finally admits the truth.
You know what? It never was about my brother.
Oh, but then things turn around quickly for her and she gets asked to dance by this guy who just happens to be one of the members of Boyz II Men. Love that for her. We then go back to Dre, who's back home and prepping for his girlfriend Lisa's return. But surprise, surprise, Katrina shows up instead.
Fellas, if you wasn't expecting her, she here to set you up, my nigga, for real. She was here to set you up, fellas. This is something that you need to know. If you wasn't expecting her, she gotta go. If you expecting somebody else and she not there, she gotta go. But you gotta be smooth with it, though. Be smooth with it. And don't... And whatever you do, fight your fucking temptation. Because you will end up like this nigga did. Because she played the fuck out of him.
His women and other evidence that they took. And this was just... She was so obvious. The awkward kisses, the slow walk, the hesitation. Katrina was like...
And she was gonna leave... Fellas, if you played it all smooth and she was going to leave and she kissed you on the cheek and all that shit, brothers, let her leave. Fight your temptations. Live to live for another fucking day. Do not, I repeat, do not do what this nigga did. Because this nigga right here fucked around and found out.
Like, I'm going to get you, but I'm going to get what I want first. Let me see what the fuss is about. Whole time they are doing the do, baby Lisa is slowly coming upstairs. And the crazy thing is, he knew she was on her way and still took their risk. No fucks were given. Not even enough time to air it out. Baby Lisa made it all the way in the house, went up the stairs, and of course, the CYA king had it handled. Child, Katrina was still there, and she snuck downstairs, and baby, his bad, risky decision proved to be fatal for his relationship, because she sets him up and beats him at his own game.
See?
Statistic where? And that's the end of the movie. And here are my final thoughts. Dre was a hot, toxic mess.
And?
Similar to A Thin Line and Boomerang and probably a host of other films around this time that followed the reformed player storyline, we see this man treat women like obstacles. However, I think one difference that sticks out to me in this movie is that we get to learn why Dre turned out this way and where this behavior came from. That damn Uncle Fred fucked him up. This fool...
Hey. Show some respect to the GOAT. That's Goldie from the Mac. Show some goddamn respect, lady. God damn it. Show some goddamn respect to the GOAT.
Who really said that women look to be played.
Yes.
And want to be played.
Yes.
Yeah. Jenny determined that was a...
That's a motherfucking truth, nigga. There ain't no motherfucking lie, it's a motherfucking truth. Now, some women, some sophisticated women, yeah, but majority of women, hell yeah, they love to be played with.
A bold-faced lie. Dre was out here listening to a decaying pimp that never got married, never had a family, and even if he wanted none of that, he's still doing the same old pimp shit in his 60s. Like, do you not see where this can lead you? And Dre spent so much time covering his ass and hiding evidence, hiding the panties and changing photos and the frames, erasing voicemails, just too much. And then manipulating his girlfriend so that she wouldn't check these things, and in turn blame herself for not being trusting, and therefore muting her own intuition that was probably screaming. Y'all, this man really met three of his women on the way to the barbecue and slept with all of them. Well, two of them. He got interrupted with Robin. And later slept with Katrina. And probably was going to sleep with Lisa. Like, what the hell? But he didn't know that when he vowed to make Katrina a statistic, he truly sealed his fate. Now, Katrina wanted to test the waters. She wanted to know what the fuss was about. But since she already knew what kind of man he was and his true plans for her, she knew to get what she wanted and do what needed to be done to bring his ass down. And all I wish is that the end scene was a little bit longer, because I wanted to see Lisa get in that ass. And poor Jenny, she was traumatized by Michael Jones. He did a number on her and made it so that she wanted to bring down any and every man like him, including her brother. I hope she healed in the end and got the love that she deserved. As for David, even though he messed up terribly, I'm glad he was able to realize that he was trying to be something he wasn't, and he succumbed to his true love and desire for Nadine, because wasn't nothing out of them streets but trouble for him. But anyway, that's it, y'all. I hope you've enjoyed watching this review. Please like.
Yeah, it was cool. You know what I'm saying? It was cool. Got to re-examine my favorite movie of all time. You know what I'm saying? This my favorite hood music. This my favorite hood movie right here. This my certified hood classic. This is my number one. And fellas, I hope you was taking notes. I hope you was taking notes. Because fellas, now what did we learn? What did we learn? A friend of a friend is going to want to get to know you, even if she knows that you ain't shit. Also, ugly women are okay. However you want to go about that with them, is how you want. If they just a booty call to you, then they're just a booty call to you. But if you really want to take it up and spice it up and do a little relationship, there's nothing wrong with that. You know what I'm saying? There could be some good benefits out of it. Hey, that ugly girl could probably have a good job. Have some money on her. You know what I'm saying? She might buy you a Rolex. She might buy you a car. Shit, she might buy you. She might buy you a motherfucking business. You never know. That ugly woman could turn out to be the best thing ever happened to your life. So, fellas, never squander an opportunity when it arises. And you always know how to be a Mac. And rule, and the final fucking rule, always fight your temptations. Don't ever fuck another bitch when you know you got your... Don't ever fuck another bitch when you know your main girl's coming through. If your main girl's coming through, that bitch gotta go. But be smooth about it, though. Keep her in mind. Let her go. You know what I'm saying? Because when she realizes that, oh, shit, he love her. He don't like he like what he see, but he love her. She gonna fight to get it. She gonna fight to get in his bed. She would have fought to get in his bed with him if he fought his temptations. But see, Dre didn't fight his temptations, and what did that do? That led to him getting caught. That's that bullshit. But anyways, no, man, that's just going about... No. We got to do soundtrack. What's it called? How to be a player. How to be a player. Soundtrack. Here we go. Yes, sir. Are y'all ready for this amazing album right here? Let's play it, man. I'm only play two songs, then we're gonna be up out of here, cause this shit is going for like an hour. She's a bad man, pajama. She's a Batman pajama, just as foxy as can be. This soundtrack go hard, bro. I ain't gonna lie to you. I mean, you gotta listen to this song that we up out of here. We gotta listen to this song that we up out of here. This 8-Ball and MJG though. This shit right here is legendary. Hey, this a hood anthem right here, bro. Here comes the one they call the P.I. Woo! Hey. Can't play the second verse, man. But anyways, though, that's just gonna about do it for this one. Let me see if it's another song on here. That's right. Tupac was on here. That's right. They did have Tupac on here. I do remember that. But they had Sugar Free on here too. Oh man. All right. But anyways, though, that's just gonna about do it for this one, man. This is definitely something that y'all need to watch on your own and learn that the macking skills, man. Because once you get them down, man, you gonna learn, man. I can't hold y'all hand. Like I said, you gotta have confidence and you gotta be smooth with it. So if you ain't got the confidence and you ain't smooth with it, none of this shit will really apply to you like you wanted to. Unless you figure it out yourself, man. I can't hold y'all hand through it, man. I could just tell you, be smooth, be confident, and be yourself. Don't try to be something that you're not. That's another lesson. That's the lesson that we learned with David, the light-skinned brother. Don't try to be something that you're not. Stick to what you know. If you're not a player, it's not meant for you. If you just trying to be out here looking for one woman and you're going to stick with that one woman, then do that shit. By all means, it's all good. But anyway, so I'm just going to about do it for this one. I'll see you all in the next video. God bless y'all, man. RIP to all the legends that we lost in this movie right here. And yeah, that's just going to about do it for this one, man. And keep on macking. Keep on macking, hanging. Macking, hanging. Come on, man. Keep macking and keep hanging. And I'll see y'all in the next one. Till then, peace out.